Club meeting of September 1st, 2021. Everybody's saying that's really scratchy. So since you can't hear the song very well, we're just not going to listen to the song at all. So I am so glad to see everybody that's here today. We've had a busy week in Rotary. We wrapped up that big project that we had going on. And we are now back to working on two other great big projects that we're going to tell you about sometime today. We got a great speaker, a fast craft talk, a visiting Rotarian, and even a couple of our own members today, which is pretty cool if you ask me. So we always start by going around the wheel and introducing ourselves. I guess I have to introduce myself. I'm Raymond Foster. I'm the president of the club. They made me president because last year I was the public image chair and they got tired of me being the face of Rotary. So we have delegated that now to Diva. I am no longer the face of Rotary. But Marianne, you're here today. What do you have to say? You must unmute yourself.
Thank you. I'm Marianne Kistler. I have been a member of Rotary for over 25 years. I am a former past president, and I am the current foundation chair.
Excellent. Thank you so much for being here today. Steve Scott.
Yes, sir. Hello, everyone. My name is Steve Scott. I am the current treasurer of the Rotary Club, past president, member of the club for about 12 years, and I am a State Farm agent in San Dimas.
Excellent. Thank you, Steve. We have a visiting Rotarian, Jill from Pomona. Hello, Jill. Well, I know you want to speak, but you're not coming out with any sounds. So I'm going to skip and say Jill Dolan from Pomona Rotary is here, and she's just so pleased and happy to be a Rotarian and to be online with the San Dimas Rotary Club. And you know who else is here is Sylvia. Hi, Sylvia from the Chamber.
Hi, everyone. I'm the CEO from the San Dimas Chamber of Commerce. My name is Sylvia, and I appreciate being here. Thank you so much.
Hey, and Craig, our dentist Rotarian, Craig. Say hello to everyone.
Hi, everyone. I'm Craig Jung. I'm a dentist in San Dimas, past president, and I forgot my business. I'm a youth chair member right now.
As long as you don't forget that you're a dentist, that will be okay. Yeah. You can forget what you do for Rotary, but just don't forget that you're a dentist or barber. I'm not sure which it is. You know, we have our guests here today. Reggie Clark is our program speaker. He will be introduced, and Mary is our fast craft talk. But before we jump into our program speaker, I'm going to share a little bit with you of our wrap up. Over here, you can see that. Please nod your heads if you can see a PowerPoint presentation on the screen. Excellent. You know, we just wrapped up our community service project, and that was at the Crossroads. And we went to a place that looks like this. Crossroads is a location that provides programmatic support and transitional housing for formerly incarcerated women. They are located in Claremont, but they bought this craftsman style home with a duplex on it in Pomona. And they were gonna make this a new part of their program. You can see that the backyard looked very, very well in need of a lot of work. And so the Rotary Club got together and with several other community organizations, including the Claremont Rotary Club, the San Dimas Masonic Lodge, a couple of local churches. We put in over 400 or 500 volunteer hours over two weekends. And this is Mike Wallace, our past president, and I at Home Depot buying the supplies that we're gonna take to this rear yard. And you can see what it was transformed to. We rebuilt a large section of the fence, painted the complete fence, cleaned everything up, laid pavers, painted down the new patio, and it looks very, very good now. There was some more follow-on work done this weekend by members of the Masonic Lodge who continued to grade and level out the backyard, but that project turned out very nice for us. And thank you to everyone who participated in assisting us. And especially thank you to Home Depot who provided us with a $1,000 grant to assist us in completing the project. So Mike Wallace, you've popped in, and before we go to our speaker, you want to introduce yourself?
I would love to. Thank you, Raymond. I apologize for my tardiness. My name is Mike Wallace. I am the president of Better Home Financial here in downtown San Dimas. I have been a Rotarian for about 6.5 years, past president, past treasurer, and I'm happy to be here serving the community.
Excellent. So we're going to go right to the program. And today we have with us Reggie Clark of Volunteers of America Homeless Outreach in the city of Pomona. Over the course of the last 4 years, he has dedicated to creating the best opportunities for homeless participants to succeed in being housed and providing as many resources to pave their way to new beginnings. He does this by working side by side with the Board of Board of Supervisors member Hilda Solis, Senator Connie Leyva, Congresswoman Norma Torres, Pomona Mayor Tim Sandoval, Neighborhood Services Director Benita DeFrank, Homeless Program Supervisor Donvel Holly, with LASA, Tri-City Mental Health, East Valley Prototypes, Goodwill, and several other stakeholders. Reggie is dedicated to serving our homeless population, always outstretching to collect financial donations and material items. He's been truly supportive of the staff, guiding them to strive to do better. He motivates participants to believe in themselves, and he personally helps physically move furniture safely into their new apartments. He's a great listener and mediator to the staff and participants, finding solutions to any issue. Welcome to the San Dimas Rotary Club.
Well, thank you so much. And good afternoon, family. It is a pleasure and an honor to be with you this afternoon. And guess what, y'all? He did it again. And I always like to start off with sharing that to say he did it again. And what I basically mean by that is, first and foremost, he woke me up this morning. He put me in an upright position. He put me in a place I've never been before in my life. And that's right here and right now. And just for that, I'm grateful. I don't have a PowerPoint for you. I'm just going to basically share with you on some of the things that Volunteers of America does, and also the connection with Volunteers of America in the city of Pomona and various programs. I just want to make a quick correction. I am not the director of Volunteers of America. I'm program manager. Okay.
One more correction, 2006.
Yes. thank you, Mary. I've been blessed to be doing this work since 2006 here in the city of Pomona. And when I started doing this work, actually, funny thing, it came to me from a friend of mine. They said to me, Reg, I think you would probably really do good at this kind of work, because I had other things that I was involved in helping people and stuff. And so I said, well, okay. I was actually in between jobs at the time. I'm formerly a 30-year printer. I worked in the printing field for 30 years. And so I said, okay, well, let me check into it. And the funny thing happened is I got two job offers from two different places for this homeless situation. And one was in Riverside and one was in Pomona. And being that I was in Pomona, I said, okay, whatever one comes through first, I would take a look at it. And thank God Pomona came through first. So I've been on this journey since 2006. I came in, I was working under Foothill AIDS Project at the time, which had the contract with the city of Pomona. And throughout the years, you know, I've been involved in going to plenty of our consortium meetings and stuff of that nature, COC meetings. And from there, the city of Pomona was looking to take some of their programs and actually allocate it to another agency. And at the time, I vouched for Volunteers of America. And so that's how Volunteers of America became part of the city of Pomona programs. I actually came with the package when they took on the city's programs. Volunteers of America have been around for over 100 something years, and they have a number of programs that was in the LA area. And so one of the things that was important to me is that we started looking at the San Gabriel Valley in SPA 3 to receive some of the services that was being given to our homeless folks that was in our area. And so I went to plenty of meetings at LASA and advocated and worked with the Board of Supervisors and everybody to start getting us some things here in our SPA. And with that being said, we started off, we only had maybe a handful of programs here in SPA 3. We got well over 20-something, 30-something programs now for homeless programs in the SPA 3. And I am very grateful for that because, you know, most of our unsheltered folks do not want to live in LA, okay? And so, you know, we needed to think about how we can assist them here in our own area. And so with that being said, we came together and we started putting some things in place. And Benita DeFranks from the city of Pomona, we sat down and we talked about what it was looking like to create something here in the city of Pomona for our homeless here and our surrounding cities. And so what happened was at the time I was running winter shelter programs. Winter shelter programs run from December to March every year. And we started off when we was doing it at the Armory here in the city of Pomona. And it was an old building and it was, oh boy, that was a job, okay? And and we was servicing about 100 people a night at the shelter in our contract. But there was days that we did about maybe 175 people based on the people that was needing some help. And so with that, we thought about it and working closely with the city and the mayor, we talked about what it would look like for us to create something that would make sense for here to address our folks here and put them in a better place to get them rapidly rehoused. So we came up with it, and I'm so grateful that I've been a part of it from the very beginning and the implementation of this, and just excited to see how it's really working. We talked about doing a shelter that we will be able to assist our folks with all the other barriers. Because a lot of times people see homeless folks and they think that their barriers is just the fact that they're homeless. Well, if any of you dealt with any homeless folks, you would know that there's an abundance of other barriers that they suffer with. And so we said, well, let's do this. Let's make it a one-stop shop. And with the one-stop shop, we were able to come together with a lot of our partners in the city of Pomona and our surrounding areas. And we talked about having a site that can address multiple barriers opposed to just homelessness. Even though the site is all about rapid rehousing, it's about housing, okay? So we came together and we said, well, let's look at the barriers. We got folks that's dealing with substance abuse. So we got a substance abuse partner to come in to be part of our shelter. Now, let me, before I say that, the shelter was built as a fabric structure, okay? And it has three other buildings on the site, beautiful site. And so the partners that we wanted to bring on was for substance abuse, which was Prototypes here in the city of Pomona. They became one of our partners on site. Then we brought in Tri-City for mental health, because we know that a lot of our folks are dealing with mental health. Anybody that's homeless definitely is dealing with some sort of depression, okay? That doesn't mean that they're crazy. It means that they're dealing with life situations that are very much bigger than them. So they do need some assistance in those areas. So we brought in Tri-City for mental health. Then we said, well, what are we gonna do about folks coming in that got medical issues? So we have a full-on clinic on site with four examining rooms. And that partner is East Valley Medical Center. So we have that on site. Then we said, well, how are we gonna work with our folks that are healthy and well and just need a job? So we brought on Goodwill for jobs. So one of the important things for me is knowing that understanding people's traumas, because folks deal with a lot of trauma, and being trauma informed is not being judgmental about what I see in front of me, okay? Opposed to what is it that I can see, how we can get to the goal. And for most of our folks, my question I ask is, what is your goal? I don't ask or tell them what I can do for them. I ask them what is their goal. Because I know that if you tell me what it is you need, then we can have that discussion, what it looks like for us to achieve it, okay? And the key to that is, when I say what it looks like for us to achieve it, meaning we're gonna become partners in your goal, in your success. So I need to be able to say, we have a part in it and you have a part in it. And a lot of our folks that in my time in doing this work, I understand that we have to encourage people to bring their self-esteem and their self-will back into play, you know? And in doing that, you give them a piece of it, because if they have something to do with accomplishing the goal, they have a better chance on sustaining it. I learned that if you just give somebody something and they have nothing to do with it, it means nothing to them. So if they lose it, oh well, right? And so I've been able to really implement a lot of different programs, not only here in the city of Pomona, but in SPA 3 in itself. And so we have rapid rehousing programs, whereas we can help folks get rapidly rehoused, and we can do subsidy for them up to 24 months, okay? And what that would look like is they'll be paying a percentage, 30% of whatever their income is, to get into a place, and this, we will pay the remaining. With that being said, there's been a lot of things have happened, and of course you all know the pandemic has really put a damper on a lot of things. And right now, it's just not that easy to house people. For one reason, there's very limited housing stock, okay? Affordable housing stock. And so what happens is we have to work with landlords to be willing to be open to accepting our people without judgments, okay? And we've been very successful with that, I would like to say. We have quite a few landlords that we work with that I think maybe about 75% of their property is our folks, okay? So which is great, because they still have that community setting, you know, and they don't feel like they left out or whatever. They see their peers doing the same thing they're doing and accomplishing the goals. So that was important to me as well. And so with that being said, I reached out to the Board of Supervisors, Mr. Solis, because I realized that we had a lot of families that was coming to us homeless. And I know that most of the time you tell them to go call 211. Well, they can call 211, 211 connect them to what they call the Family Solution Center. And the Family Solution Center works with them. Well, I found that there was a glitch in that, because I understood that people were homeless point in time, meaning right now. Not that they need to wait for an appointment or get an appointment, which appointments sometimes could be 2-3 weeks down the line. So I brought that to the supervisor's attention, and she was kind enough to allocate some discretionary funds for me to have motel vouchers, okay? And these motel vouchers were, whereas I can place a family into a motel up to 30 days as we're working on the plan of what's the next moves. Because we know that we don't want no family out in the streets with their kids, and then they end up having their kids taken away from them. Let me know when I'm getting close to time, because I it's a lot I have, but I'm not gonna give it all to you, okay? But so I'm grateful for her with that, and she gave me 1 year, and then next time around, she didn't give me a 1 year contract, she gave me a 2 year contract. So she understood the need as well. And so this year, in the past 2 years with COVID hitting, we just been going through a whole lot. Our site has been on quarantine quite a few times, actually is on quarantine at this time. And we are not taking any new intakes in because of the outbreak that we had. And so it's just been one thing after another. But Volunteers of America itself also have a number of other programs as well. I was just sharing with you about some of the stuff in the city of Pomona. But we did the project room keys. We got a project home key in Hacienda Heights. We got some new projects that's coming up. November, we about to open up a hotel in El Monte, South El Monte, working with the city of El Monte. We have a new project with the tiny homes. I don't know if you ever heard about the tiny homes. Well, we're about to do tiny homes in Baldwin Park, 25 units. And then of course we got winter shelter coming back up. So there's a number of things happening. And right now we're really fighting with, believe it or not, people wanting to work. You know, it's hard to get people to want to work right now. And I think a lot of it is because a lot of people are able to get subsidized or get some money from some places, and they just say, well, I'm just gonna run this out. But it's a struggle right now to get people to wanna work. One thing about this work, you just can't get anybody to do this work, okay? This is not something that just anybody can do. It's gotta take someone that has, first and foremost, the compassion to want to be able to help somebody. Not so much you looking at this as what your paycheck gonna look like. Because you're dealing with human beings and they want to feel that they mean something to somebody. And so, you know, we have challenges all the time. You know, we got folks that, you know, my staff, I work with them a lot because they you gotta have a tough skin to do this work, right? Because, you know, we know our people are going through things and they might come in to the shelter and they got a bad day and they might have been drinking or whatever and they might cuss at you or, you know, something to that effect. And we are a housing first model and we are a low barrier model. So I always tell my folks, if you can make it to the shelter and you drunk and you can follow my rules and get to your bed and sleep it off, you got a bed. Okay, because in turn, what I know that does is take that off of our police department for having throw somebody in the drunk tank overnight and babysit them. So I'm willing to take that on to babysit them, long as we are all in the same place, you know, of where we're heading. So there's a lot of things that's happening right now. There's a lot of programs. They just came out with this new EHV vouchers. County came up with 6,000 vouchers or whatever for like Section 8 vouchers. Here in the city of Pomona, they got allocated 78 vouchers. And we went to bat with LASA to let them utilize it for our people here. And we were able to do that. And right now we have quite a few people that's in line to get into their housing with these vouchers. And these are like Section 8 vouchers, which is great. And they don't have those stipulations on them far as having to have a disability or what have you. Because, you know, other vouchers before, you had to have a disability in order to receive a voucher. So once again, I'm just excited on making the best choices possible to be able to help people get to a better place. Now, I need the help. I always put it out there. I need you to help me help you, okay? And if we come together and do that, we can get someplace. I am so grateful to you guys for the work that you do. You've been of assistance to us in many ways. And I'm excited about the project that you shared about Crossroads, okay? I've dealt with them many, many years ago, and I know what they do over there, and that's a positive thing for some of our people that's coming out of incarceration that needs a place and need another chance, you know. And we, Volunteers America, is a felon-friendly organization, and I have hired people that have done 30 years in prison, okay, because they have the opportunity to have a chance as well. So with that, I don't know if I missed anything. Mary is like, she's wonderful. She helps us with making sure that we get all of our donations and all that kind of stuff in place. She does a lot of these meetings for us, you know, because I think I have meetings like every 5 minutes, as well as you probably guys probably have. But I just appreciate you taking the time to hear what it is we do. And if you have any questions, I hope I can be able to answer them for you. Thanks for having me once again.
You're welcome. I had a question for you. You mentioned the lack of housing stock. How much of that is a problem for you? How much is it a housing problem as opposed to the other problems associated with homelessness?
Well, it's a big problem right now based on the moratorium, right? The moratorium, because the fact that people are staying in housing right now that probably wouldn't be able to be there because they don't have to pay rent. So there's not many things coming available for us. And I keep pushing them, talking about we have to build more affordable housing. We need more low-income housing. And I'm looking at here in the city of Pomona, I see some structures going up and ain't near none of them affordable housing.
No. Now you talked about, are you involved with the Ballin Park Small Houses project?
Yes, the tiny homes, yes.
The tiny homes. And what generally, what do those tiny homes cost?
What? I don't know exactly how much they cost. I have this is what it looks like. And yeah, this is our first go around with this project with the tiny homes. And I was just on a call about it because I was wondering what was the things that was gonna be in this tiny home. And it's very tiny.
Yes, they are very small.
Yeah.
I would like to hear more information about that. Maybe we can have a conversation at offline. Does anyone else have any questions for our guest, Reggie from BOA and Hope for Homes?
Craig, I just want ahead. To say thank you for coming again and talking and just giving us more information.
Thank you.
I think Jill had a question.
Thank you, Reggie.
She wrote, Pomona Rotary provides dinner once a month. How else can Pomona and San Dimas assist the Pomona site? And what needs do you have?
Well, at this time, actually, I will let Mary answer that question because she's the one that usually receives things that we need, know what we need. I'm all over the place. So, Mary?
As far as donations go, preferably due to COVID, we are asking for brand new items. So if you feel that's on your heart to buy clothing, especially undergarments, that's very important that we want to keep everything brand new. T-shirts are always necessary, pants, and also shower shoes. I can send a list. And if that can be emailed, that way I can save you from the whole conversation right this second. But I can send a list and definitely let you know more of all
that.
Our needs. Yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much for asking.
You're welcome. And so we will be in February conducting another food drive. We collected 2 tons of food in February of last year. Our goal is 4 tons this year. We'll be working with some other San Dimas organizations. And we've designated some of that to the 29 Palms food bank out at the Marine Corps base. But what I think we'd like to do is get that list and put that out for people to make specific item donations, and we can set that aside. So we should get you on that committee, and I'm going to write that down as a note to let you know when we crank that over, because having specific requests, people give, and we can probably collect quite a bit of what you need. I think we can help out that way. That sounds like a really cool thing.
That being said, too, sir, I just want to mention, too, and Mary, because we have programs that we house people, mm-hmm. sometimes we're housing people and we buying furniture and all that kind of stuff for them as well. So, and sometimes we have people that's in housing that still struggling, need donations and stuff of that nature. So if Mary, we can look at that as well.
Also write a note to yourself, Mary, when we talk, one of the things that I'm also interested in, and our club I think would be interested in also, is putting together move-in kits for people who are moving into a location and don't have pots and pans, bedding, toiletries. And so we would create a, you know, and these would be rather expensive, but I think if we could put four or five move-in kits together, that, you know, when somebody moves in, like, you know, if you were, if I was moving, we'd use those pod things and take everything across country and it would appear at the doorstep. If we could do something like that, I think that would be very helpful. So let's talk offline and go forward with a couple of ideas.
Absolutely. Thank you so much.
Well, thanks again, Reggie. And we're going to move because we got to move to Mary pretty quick here. boy, yeah, if you're interested in joining together with my club, let me know. Jill, of course, we are very interested. One of the things about the San Dimas Rotary, we haven't anything for 2 years done it without a partner, but we've done fabulous things with partners. It doesn't matter who gets the credit because we're willing to do the work. And so that's why we've gotten all this good stuff done. And yes, we will be reaching out to you, Jill, 100%. You know what? Our fine master is not here. However, as you know, it's I'm fine, you're fine, it's not so fine. The more your thing becomes a gripe, the more it costs you. Does anybody have anything they want to be not fine about? Come on, I know there's somebody out there. All right, well, I'll lead off. Oh, go ahead, Mike. Thank you.
I am fine. Everything's fine. But I'm going to find myself $5 because we're coming up on a three-day weekend, and I feel like everybody needs a little bit of a break. So I'm fine, and here's to a three-day weekend.
Excellent. Very cool. All right, anybody else for the fine? All right, I'm going to put myself down for $10 and it's going to, because it'd be a bit of a complaint. my wife is on her way to Mexico on Friday to cement a deal with some real estate that we accidentally own. And she has to have a notarized power of attorney from her sister. And her sister brings it over Thursday, but as we're packing Friday night, we determine at 7 o'clock, it is not notarized. 7 o'clock, Friday night, an unnotarized document and a flight in the morning. And as my wife begins to go like an Atlas II rocket, what I say to her is, we can solve any problem, get in the car. We called 30 notary republics and found somebody to meet us in an alley in Hollywood off Beechwood Drive, literally in an alley on the trunk of a car with a flashlight at 11 o'clock at night on a Friday night. I found a notary republic that's worth 10 bucks. That was my adventure for the weekend. And so we had quite a weekend. That was it. Anybody else? That's my $10 story.
Hey Raymond, if that ever happens again, just call me. We get documents notarized all the time. We have people that will go 24 hours a day anywhere. So just give me a call and I can put you in contact with somebody.
I wish I had thought of that. That didn't even come to mind. I'm gonna
take it a step further, Raymond, and find myself $10. For not telling you that I'm a notary.
Are you kidding me?
No, I am I'm a notary. Have been for 12 years.
You see, and you keep that a secret because what you get $15 a signature, and you don't want to get hassled.
it's a lot of work, but you know, if you ever need it done for you on a Friday night, I would have come out and met you.
Oh, man, I cannot believe that. See, well, thank you very much. I should find myself $20 now for being stupid and not asking my friends and trying to solve. See, that's what happens when you try to solve a problem on your own. You always end up getting double whammy. Hey, so let's go over to our Fast Craft Talk. A Fast Craft Talk is a 5-minute portion of the meeting where somebody in the community comes and tells us about their passion. And we have a really cool person with us today, and that is Mary. Hello, Mary.
Hello, everyone. My name is Mary Tuadros. I'm the Partner Relations Specialist for Volunteers of America, Hope for Home, Pomona. And today I'm here actually to represent Agenda for Prophetic Faith organization. They've been doing really great work over the last 15 years. And it's the largest and longest running series of lectures on religion and politics in the country, and even served as an academic consultant for many, many organizations across. So I'm just going to share about our reparations conference coming up September and September 25th at 6 p.m. I'm going to read what it's about. And it is a Reparations as a Just Act Zoom conference, discussion led by Reverend Lewis Chase, guest speakers, Dr. Karinga, and Rabbi Stephen Jacobs. About this event, we are on the cusp of a major social, moral, and ethical revolution that will transform the African-American community and the unborn for generations to come. This event will provide the why and the how of America's reckoning with systematic racism and its response. This is the context of our forthcoming virtual conference, Reparations as a Just Act. Dr. Karinga will speak to the urgency, the reckoning, and the call to action for what our nation needs to do. He will talk about a new start where all systems are called to work together for people to thrive and for us to create justice for our community. Although money is important, it alone will not be enough to repair the damage caused by 400 years of systematic racism. Rabbi Stephen Jacobs will bring a historical and biblical account of reparations from a Jewish perspective. Tickets can be purchased from Eventbrite. I'm going to put that in the link in the message so everyone can see that. And I have emailed it to you and also our flyer. And I'm just going to show you really quick. This is our flyer for September 25th. And it is 6 p.m. to 7:30 p.m. Tickets are only $15. We really encourage you to get involved and listen to this discussion. It's powerful. And it's only $5 for students across the board, college students, high school students, any students. And the main point, this is important, the reason why tickets are being sold is because the money collected is actually going to go to a scholarship. And we want to give it to an African-American student. We haven't narrowed down which college yet or which program or organization, but that is the purpose of the funds, and that's where that money's going. So please definitely share if you're unable to go. Just still purchase a ticket. It would bless someone greatly. And we're just very excited to have this opportunity to share with you. And thank you so much for giving me this opportunity today.
Well, thank you so much. And I will make sure your flyer, which I do have, will go out to all our club members now that they are aware of what it's going to be coming. And also anyone who is watching on YouTube or on the KWST rebroadcast, if they will email sandimasrotary@gmail.com, I will send a copy of the flyer to you also. So anybody who wants further information, thank you so much, Mary, for not only coming, but also getting Reggie here. I know he's busy, and so corralling him is a lot of work. So let's go to Action 360. Hey, we have a lot going on. The first thing I want to make everybody aware of, or make sure you're aware of, is I'm going to put this up on the screen. Give me a moment. Hey, so our raffle tickets are here. $6,800 travel voucher, $5 raffle tickets. This is our major fundraiser. I have 10,000 tickets in my office. That's 10,000. And I'm waiting for Steve to give me the go from the state. We have taken care of all of the, Steve and Barbara have been fabulous about jumping through the state hoops to get this registered. Now, this is the important part. We make money on this by sharing it. And here's what we do. Any Rotary Club or civic organization who wants to buy a pack of a block of 100 tickets for $1 each and resell them for $5 and keep the $4 for their project is more than welcome to contact us, and we'll invoice you for that 100 tickets. That's any Rotary Club. We already have 7 Rotary Clubs on board to purchase tickets. Or any community organization wants to sell them, and we will provide them at a 50-50 split. Please let us know. You keep 250, we keep 250, and this is how we're gonna go forward with this, and we're gonna make a ton of money for everybody. So we had two committee meetings about making spirits bright. That is our project working with the Diamond Bar Women's Club, the San Dimas Masonic Lodge, and our community co-chair is Councilman Eric Weber. Two events to support that project. That project is to provide Christmas gifts to enlisted Marine Corps personnel at 29 Palms and Camp Pendleton. The goal was to raise $15,000. We've raised $8,000 so far, and we have two events. Now, as you know, our club committed $1,000 in its budget. Well, guess what? With the hockey game, we now have a volunteer or a charity hockey game, which will take place on October 23rd. A flyer and a link will be coming out at the Toyota Arena. That's a 9,800-seat arena. The first part of the hockey game will be a minor league hockey game. And then after that, the LAPD team will take the play, will take the ice against the veterans team. And any money, we get a percentage of the gate through the link. And that goes all to making spirits bright. The Veteran Hockey League, or it's called the Patriot League, has told us to anticipate between $2,000 and $3,000. So that covers our grand right there. The next thing we have coming up is the Diamond Bar Women's Club, along with our Rotary Club, and at the San Dimas Masonic Lodge, will be having a spaghetti dinner fundraiser at the lodge on November 10th. The tickets are $15 each, and it includes a program with a keynote speaker, and we're selling space and a program guide for sponsorships. So this will raise at least $1,500, if not more. The young Marines from the San Dimas community are participating in presenting the colors and serving the food. We have a program speaker, a keynote speaker coming out from the Marine Corps base. And so we have this getting lined up. And the good news is that covers us completely on that $1,000. And so we've been working with, been working on our international service project. Anybody have any questions, by the way, about those two events? October 23rd and November 10th. Put those in your calendars. Okay. The second is our international service project. Derek is our service chair, and our sister club is the Elon Bulagon Kenya Rotary Club. It is a very rural province of Kenya, right next to the border with Uganda. And we have entered into preliminary discussions. In fact, we now have a committee forming up, and our community co-chair in this project will be City Councilman Bertone. He's agreed to participate with us. And what we're going to be doing is looking at the top 100 secondary school students. They have a different tier system there for high school, but the 100 students going on to university in Kenya, and we're looking at providing each of them a laptop computer, because much of their stuff is becoming distance learning also. And so the Sister Rotary Club in Kenya, along with, thank you, my Alexa decided to go off. Thank you very much. Stop. All right, thank you. So we get that going on, and we'll have more about this as we go on. If you want to be on this committee and you don't have to be part of the club to get into the committee, let me know. Lastly, because of all the good work you all did, a community member, Mike, stepped up and said, you did such good work, here's $10,000, do something else with it. And so we formed a community foundation. Those bylaws that we voted on and the articles of incorporation are before Betsy, who is our district governor and a nonprofit attorney. And she's reviewing them for us, and we should have them back shortly. And we will be up and running as the San Dimas Rotary Community Foundation within probably 30 days. And that is really super, because that gives us, just takes us to another level as people who are doing great work in the community. So any questions on the like five things I threw at you? All right, hey Sylvia, we have a couple of minutes extra here. Is there anything from the chamber we need to know about?
Yes, thank you so much for the opportunity to speak. So we have an upcoming event that we want to share with everybody. It's the San Dimas Wine and Beer Walk. It's on October the 2nd from 5 to 8:30. We shut down downtown San Dimas, and there's 20 stops, and you could go around and shop and eat and drink. And it's going to be a really fun time. We have four bands and a dance group that's also going to come out. Should be a lot of fun. We invite everybody to attend. Tickets could be found on Eventbrite if you look for San Dimas Wine and Beer Walk, or here at the San Dimas Chamber office. Thank you so much.
Oh, very cool. We're looking forward to that.
And Raymond, if I may, I'd also just like to say that event has sold out every year that we've done it. So don't wait to get your tickets. Absolutely. Get them early, because we do sell out every single year.
Absolutely. Mike, thank you. Will we be able to sell raffle tickets in front of your business there again this year?
Sure, absolutely.
Absolutely, yes.
Sylvia said no, but I'm saying yes.
I didn't. No, I'll put you guys down. I definitely
yeah,
you guys
absolutely. Down. We can do that. No problem.
Excellent. That's going to be a great place. So we're going to. So a couple of you need to write that down and get tickets so that we can have somebody there to sell those tickets, those raffle tickets, and make our fundraiser. So anybody have anything else before we look at the calendar? All right. What do we got coming up? Well, we have Emily Chambard from TCP Global Micro Grants next week. Remember, on September 9th, there will be a board meeting. That agenda will be going out very quickly. If you'd like something to be placed on the agenda, please send me an email. I've invited Art from KWST to come and talk to us. They have been a great silent partner for like 14 months, rebroadcasting our meetings. I just asked him to come and say, tell us what goes on over there, and what other program is there, and how it works out at the University of Lorraine. That should be very interesting. Our next club assembly, that's our in-person meeting, is on September 29th at noon. It will be at City Hall, and the mayor, Emmett, will be our keynote speaker. We have speakers almost all the way out through the first of the year. The calendar looks great. They're always interesting. You're all encouraged to attend. Thank you very much. Last thing is for Rotary, the four-way test. And I'm going to read it to you. This is such a high bar. And I said this last week, one of the things about the Rotary four-way test is it acknowledges the complexities of human relationships by looking and saying, of all the things we say or do, is it the truth? Is it fair to all concerned? Will it build goodwill and better friendships? Will it be beneficial to all concerned? To pass all four of those tests is one of the things that is very difficult in life because relationships are so complex. But it gives us a guide, and as Rotarians in our personal lives, our business lives, and in our nonprofit and community work lives, it's something that we strive to make sure that we attain. So thank you so much for attending today's Rotary meeting. I sincerely appreciate it, and I'm looking forward to seeing all of you back next week. I don't know why you're spotted.
Bye, thank you.
Bye-bye, everybody.